Tonight, we begin a series on the changing landscape of energy in the U.S. and the consequences of ever-increasing development. Ray Suarez is our guide this week. Tonight, he visits the booming economy in western North Dakota, where new drilling technologies have opened up massive oil reserves.
In western North Dakota, near the Montana border, there's so much oil around, it almost feels risky to say it. Boom. A 1% unemployment rate. Heavy traffic in what was once a sleepy town of 12,000. Nowhere to live. Restaurants that close early because they can't find enough people to work at 15 bucks an hour. And others offering signing bonuses to dishwashers and fast food workers.
Geologists say there's a small ocean of oil, hundreds of billions of barrels, trapped underground here in North Dakota. So, thousands of workers have flocked to Williston to pull it out.
Instant towns rose instead of corn and wheat as Williston joined a new American energy boom, driving growth in parts of the West. Just 2 years ago, the United States was importing two-thirds of its oil. Today, imports are down to less than half U.S. oil needs. Oil companies have known about these supplies for decades, but new technology makes the deposit known as the Bakken profitable to drill.
So where's the surface location?
Lance Langford manages the Bakken for the international energy company Statoil.
It's just the tip of the iceberg right now. We're going to be here for many, many years. And once we're finished drilling these wells will produce for 30 to 40 years.
For Williston, that means growing pains and a gusher of cash, surging through a town not totally ready for it. Williston's population doubled in size in 2 years. Suddenly, the parking lots are full with cars from all over and job seekers coming from every direction. Joe Gunderson moved from Montana and says he's making the best money of his life.
It's been good. It's been really good. I mean, anything you want. Money's not really an issue. I mean, if you want it, you just buy it and make it work.
The word's out. Men are getting in their cars and trucks and driving to North Dakota.
It's easy to find a job here. It's just what you're going to get is the issue. Within 24 hours of being here, I already had maybe five different job offers and took one of them.
Tyler's working as a cook until something opens up in the oil fields and living in his car.
Oh, that's the food section down there. That's the kitchen. Out back, that's toiletries. Essentially, what I do is I move everything from the back to the front whenever I want to sleep, and then the front to the back whenever I want to drive around or can fit a passenger in. I have my cooler. I have a lot of good camping gear, but there's nowhere to camp around here unless I want to pay a ridiculous amount of money. Yeah, welcome to my home.
So for now, home is a parking place. The price of housing comes up again and again from longtime residents, newcomers, and businesses. Labor-hungry companies have found one solution, workers' camps built and operated by outside contractors like Target Logistics. Workers who can't find an affordable place to live want to leave Williston. A clean, decent room in a sturdy prefab building, three big meals a day, and a private shower all take a little of the sting out of an 80-hour week.
You don't want a bunch of permanent housing sitting around there on the market.
Regional Vice President Travis Kelly oversees accommodation for almost 4,000 workers in Williston for housing contractor Target Logistics.
I know the general public, when they see one of our lodges, they think, oh, it's just a man camp, and you know, these are rough and tumble guys getting in fights all the time. It's really not true. The demographic of folks that we have staying with us come from all over the country. And most of them are family guys. They have wife and kids that they're trying to support back at home.
Jeff Burgos didn't expect to wind up running a kitchen in a workers' camp 1,500 miles from home or living dorm style without his wife and family. When the economic crisis hit, he tried to hang on, but eventually had to close his restaurant in Mesa, Arizona.
My first week here, I didn't sleep much, but, you know, thank God to technology. You know, I'm on the little phone every night, you know, with Skype, and see my kids every day, tell them good night, you know, give them the old kiss on the phone. And it's not the same, but at least they see my face, I see their face, and I'm able to tell my wife that I love her, and it's like looking right at her.
Yeah, and normally we...
Trying to manage his city's wild ride is Mayor Ward Kozer. Thousands of new people crowd the roads, drive up local wages, and mean the local sewer system has to handle thousands more flushes.
Well, probably one of the biggest things that we are faced with is the cost of employees for the city. In other words, we added three policemen last year, we added six policemen this year, three more dispatchers, seven people in public works, building inspectors, planners, basically down the road you have to add these people.
Raising the cost of local government by almost $3 million. And the town has had to borrow the money for personnel and infrastructure like new streets and garbage collection. The surge in oil royalties and sales taxes is collected by the state, not by Williston.
Here we have a rig, this is Statoil, that's drilling. They're actually looking to drill four wells off of this location. It's interesting how close it is to the city. There's a human cost in this whole process, just the stress that is raised. You know, North Dakota has always been known as a really stress-free state. And I don't know that Williston would be considered that right now.
The mayor seems to have his finger on his constituents' pulse.
We're frustrated with lack of housing. We're frustrated with lack of services. You know, we're frustrated with traffic. We're frustrated with driving. You know, we're not alone. And I don't care whether you've been here a long time or a short time. We all are. There's not enough police. There's not enough ambulance. There's not enough fire. There's not enough restaurants. There's not enough anything.
The traffic woes come from a tremendous rise in truck traffic. Hydraulic fracturing takes millions of gallons of water pumped under high pressure into underground wells to break open oil deposits. The water hauled around Williston by hundreds of tanker trucks. And water that's dirty has to go someplace after it's used. The possibility of contaminated water making its way into local water supplies worries some longtime residents. Mark Treshock directed the Dakota Resource Council for the past 18 years.
Last spring, when we had a very wet spring season, we had over 50 reserve pits across the state, which contain drilling fluids and mud and oil and lots of stuff you don't want in your water, and overflowed during that spring thaw, and some of them got into surface water.
A saltwater pipe broke on Linda Monson's land and contaminated soil and the water source her cattle rely on.
Actually, they say that the creek is okay to drink out of. There's just one spot down here where they're pumping the water out from underneath the ground, and there is a spot where it is coming to the top of the ground, and they don't want them to drink out of that yet either. They keep testing it.
Ken Salazar is the Secretary of the Interior and knows there are worries nationwide about fracking fluid.
And so that's why we have proposed and are moving forward to finalize rules that will require full disclosure to the American public of the kinds of fluids that are being injected, requirements that will make sure that there's well bore integrity so you don't have leakage of fluids out into water-bearing aquifers.
Salazar recently visited North Dakota and says he's glad to see the development and the jobs.
There's a lot of opportunities.
Mayor Kozer, if it all goes according to plan?
As we grow, I think there's quality of life things that we can do so that some of these people who are moving here temporarily just to work will fall in love with Williston, North Dakota, and that's where I want to live. I want to start a family here. I want to raise my family here.
And maybe, if Williston gets it right, Mayor Kozer hopes, longtime residents will fall in love again with their transformed hometown.
Our energy series continues tomorrow when Ray reports from Colorado, where a major coal producer is betting all on natural gas. And online, you can find more about the impact on boom towns like Williston, North Dakota. We have an interview with John McChesney, a former NPR reporter, who has a new documentary about this from the Center for the American West at Stanford University.